var det inte helt så att jag ska få plats på TV. Samtidigt.
water.
Yeah.
You want some?
Yes, please. Thank you.
Yeah.
I would like to welcome Kimberly Motley, the only Western litigator in Afghanistan and the main character of the documentary Motley's Law, currently screening at the Gothenburg Film Festival. And the next time the film will be showed is today at half past five at School of Business, Economics and Law. You are also awarded by the Chamber's Women in Law Awards in the United States for a passion for justice, and your challenge is outdated cultural norms and focuses on human rights, they said. And you have also given a TED talk on your mission to raise the bar question of legal representation globally. So I'm very happy that you are here, and we are very happy that you are here and want to discuss some issues with us. And I will also...
Thank you. Thanks.
I will also give the opportunity to the audience to pose questions in the meanwhile. But first, I would like to start to ask you about the reason for coming to Afghanistan in the first place. I think I heard in the film, or I think it was in the film, that you participated as a defense justice advisor in an education for Afghan lawyers.
Right.
In the regime of UNICEF. So was it? So why did you take this opportunity to go there, and what are the reasons for you staying there in Afghanistan?
Well, originally I went to Afghanistan in 2008, and as I said in the movie, I went there based on a financial opportunity. At the time, prior to going to Afghanistan, I was working as a criminal defense lawyer and had been for a number of years, and going to Afghanistan was an opportunity to make more than triple my current salary. And so I had a lot of student loans. I mean, just sort of to put dollars and cents on things, you know, going to school as I did, it, you know, unlike the system here, which I think is great, for me to go to school costs $20,000 a year. You know, and I have four college degrees. My husband has four college degrees. Healthcare is extremely expensive. And we have three children. So it really was a financial opportunity, which is why I originally went to Afghanistan. Now, what has kept me in Afghanistan is still finances, but also more than that. It's more about legal representation. It's more about really trying to help build a justice system kind of from the inside out. And so that's sort of what has kept me in Afghanistan, is sort of those other motivations that came into play, unexpected motivations that came into play once I quit the job in 2009 and decided to go off on my own. And, you know, when I went off my own, I opened my own practice. And to be honest, the first 9 months that I started practicing independently, I did everything pro bono because I didn't want to take people's money and, you know, lose and mess them up and then leave the country. So I wanted to make sure that I knew what I was doing. And then after that, then I was able to charge people.
So then, if you come as an American lawyer to a system that you know not know so much about, what are the challenges, would you say, to work in a country with the legal system so different from the system that you have been trained in within the American? Afghan law is not only formal law, it's also informal law. And that is a difference between Afghanistan and the United States. So what would you say, what are the main challenges to go to that different kind of system?
Well, I think one of the main challenges is understanding the culture more, even more so than the legal system. Because, you know, now my practice has grown to where I have clients on every continent except for Antarctica. And so I've learned that in Afghanistan, no matter where I go, it's really about learning the culture, learning the personality of the people, and the law is obviously very important, but that's almost secondary. And I find it specifically in a country like Afghanistan, what makes it even more interesting is it's a place where often unwritten legal, unwritten cultural practices trump written laws. And so, for an example, I've seen many people that have been found guilty in absentia while they weren't present, and they were simply sitting in the prison, and the government decided not to bring them to court. But according to Afghan law, everyone has the right to be present for, you know, to present their evidence, to face their what they're being accused of. And so that's where I've seen where unwritten cultural bad practices of not bringing a person to court trump the written law of a person's right to be present in court. And I see that a lot with a lot of different things in Afghanistan.
So I would like to show you one sequence from the film, if we can have the first sequence. And then I have a question to you about this.
No sharing of court documents, and the response we get today is, that's our problem. According to the Holy Quran, it says human beings are to be honored. And also, according to Islamic Sharia law, it says that everyone has the right to confront evidence against them. Anthony has not been given that respect or that right for 2.5 years. Still. Like, I'm a defense attorney, so I might be marching for, you know, a person that was wrongly murdered today, and then tomorrow I might represent somebody that's charged with murder. You know what I mean? So I can't really put myself, like, I think ethically, like for me, morally, ethically, I don't really want to put myself in that situation, because I believe in representation for all. Even if you're 100% guilty, I believe that, you know, you have the right to legal representation. I've been here for 5 years. I've seen a lot of nasty things. I've been a lawyer for 10 years. I've seen a lot of nasty things here and the US. So I've seen humans act very inhumane in a lot of different situations. I'm a defense attorney. Usually I'm defending people that have done things that are bad to other people. You know what I mean? So I'm sort of used to people being disappointing to a certain extent. I mean, I don't practice Afghan law. I practice law in Afghanistan, practice law in the US. You know what I mean? It's not about I'm practicing Afghan law, I practice law. You know, wherever I'm at, you just have to understand how to get to the human that you're dealing with.
Okay, in this sequence, you say something that I was a bit curious to hear you explore a bit more on. You say, I don't practice Afghan law. I practice law in Afghanistan. I practice law in the United States. It's all about how to get to the human that you are dealing with. So my question is then, what do you mean with law here? Is it, do you adhere to natural law, or you mean the UN human rights system, or is it the American Constitution, or what is law when you say I practice law?
Well, what I mean by I practice law in Afghanistan, I don't practice Afghan law, is that, you know, for me as a human being, as a lawyer, as a professional, I practice law in the way that my personality has developed how I personally practice law. You know, every lawyer has their own personality and how they present stuff, just like I do. And so I don't go to Afghanistan and practice law in the way that most Afghan lawyers do, which is why I say I don't practice Afghan law. You know, I practice law in Afghanistan. And how I practice law in Afghanistan is, and everywhere, is by using the laws that are available to me. So I don't come in and bring in U.S. laws because that doesn't make any sense in Afghanistan. I use the formal laws to which Afghanistan has legalized. I use the laws, or excuse me, the chapters and verses within the Holy Quran that are available to the benefit of my client, because a lot of people forget that it is the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan. So Islamic law is extremely important. And I also use the international conventions to which Afghanistan is a signatory to. And so I use all these things, and I use all these laws or these notes within my toolbox to figure out how to deal and mold with different cases with different clients. So with every case that I do, I just reshuffle how I use the laws for that case. You know, I update my playlist when there's new laws. If there's a case that's similar to an old case, I remix that playlist and I use that to the benefit of my clients in the way that I practice laws on those particular cases. Mm-hmm. And so that's what I do. I work the system from the inside out, and I use the laws or use the notes, the tools that are available to me within these systems mm-hmm. for the benefit of my clients.
Mm-hmm. So would you then say that the main result of your work, is it the successes of the individual cases, or do you think that engaging in individual cases can have an effect on the legal system as a whole?
I mean, I tend to think that every single case is important, and I think, you know, to be honest, that a lot of cases that I do in Afghanistan, they get a lot of attention, and people really take note of it a little bit more than when I practice in the U.S. And so, I do think, in different ways, I am sort of working to build the legal system, or help to not build it, but I guess help to develop it in a different way. And I believe that the way that I practice law, you know, it can be replicated to a certain extent. And so I do try to have cases where they are precedent-setting cases, you know, like for instance, you know, I've represented women that are victims of domestic violence or huge or like really significant violence. And, you know, I was the first person to do that. And that was a law that was available to people that no one was using. Victims were going to court basically unrepresented. And so we were able, you know, I was able to represent Sahar Ghul as the first victim that was represented. You know, I've represented women for rape cases like Gulnaz. And it was the first time that the president gave a pardon for a rape crime in Afghanistan, which is huge. And then also he decriminalized running away as a crime. And then also there was a unit within the Attorney General's office that was developed where victims can now report that they are victims of domestic violence or other kinds of crimes. So that was huge. You know, I represented the first foreigner in the anti-corruption court, and Bill Shaw. We lost the first trial, but in the second trial we received a not guilty. And we used the tool, you know, so there's been a lot of firsts that I have had and that I'm very fortunate to have within the country that I think definitely have helped mold the system a little bit more in terms of criminal defense work to help others.
So I'm a bit curious about how to get access to the Afghan law. You say you use the all available tools, and that's, I think, is a sympathetic way to think as a lawyer. But when it comes to the Afghan law, how access is the law? Have you been able to get access to it, or are you relying on translators? And that is also when you are proceeding. In the film, we can see that you have a translator to translate what you are saying and what they say. So what kind of translator is it? Is it a legal educated person? And how is it to work with this? Are you sure that you hear the things that you should hear?
Right. Well, I mean, Khalil, who you saw in the film, is the translator that has been with me the longest. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I don't rely on translators for the law. And I have all the laws available to me. You know, I'm physically in the country, so it's easy for me to get the hard copies of the law, but they're not all available soft copies. A lot of the laws are officially translated in English. And frankly, for those laws that aren't or are officially translated in English, I have a translator translate the law for me. Mm. I have three translators that translate the law. Because I want to get it as exact as possible. Because as a lawyer, with laws, every single word counts. And so, you know, with the film, you got to see a lot of the tail end of the work that was done. But to be honest, with every single trial that I've done, we will have spent at least 200 hours on average on that trial before you even step into court. So we spend a lot of time on every single case. Mm. And all that time involves, I don't rely on just one translator in terms of writing things down. They go through at least three translators. So everything that I say in court, the judges have, even in the first scene, they have my arguments written down that I've given to them, and I give it to them in English and Dari. Mm. And so, you know, Khalil knows me the most in terms of translators. There's some translators that work for me that the other translators just don't know work for me. You know, so I keep it very, it's very different because I, you know, it's just how we have to operate. There's some people that work for me that have no idea where my office is, you know, and so it's sort of been a trial and error type of business and situation. But I think it's worked. You know, we've been very successful in court. We've won every case, final disposition in court for every single client we've represented. And that's not easy to do after being in the country for over 7 years. We've gotten 3 presidential pardons, which is huge. You know, a lawyer is lucky to get 1 pardon from a president. We've gotten 3, and we're on our 4th now. You know, we're working on arguing another case now, which we're really thinking we'll get a pardon for that. You know, so I don't know if this is the exact right way to do it, but it's the way that has worked for us. Mm.
So how is it to work in a country that has this formal system and the informal system? Is it a strict division between them, or are they mixed so that you in the formal system also use informal law? Could you explore a bit about these parallel legal systems?
Sure. Well, I mean, parallel legal systems basically exist in almost every country. You have it here in Sweden. We have it here in the U.S., where we call it arbitration and mediation. That's informal. In Afghanistan, they call it jirgas. Mm-hmm. You know, the formal system for all of us is courts and courtrooms in a building. So, you know, I look at it as I've always worked within the formal and informal system. It just has been in different jurisdictions, and Afghanistan is obviously a different jurisdiction, but I do come with that knowledge, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Okay, let's look at another sequence.
Chocolate. Mara's gonna bring chocolate. I forgot. I know. Next time. Okay. How long you been married? 1 year. All right. How old is your husband?
Okay. But the chick has just seen the cheat at home. Faraz Manzel run away.
Running away?
Yeah. Biduni and Faraz Manzel. That do see it. But on the gate at home with the hamshini. Zana, adultery.
Okay. Okay, so what happened? What are they saying that you did?
Dubai
خوندم تو روم داشتم شب رو چیزا میخوام میزمان ده بودم که بگید ما پیش کردم که من نمیخورم خود شبر من میخوام چون مدایین در نماز قرآن خورستم تو من نمیخورم ده ای دستا گفت بخدی اون رو بخوینه من اجازه خواهم میتونی که من نمیخورم من نخوردم رفیق چکورد خوب سعی.
Wait, real quick. When you said that people didn't look so good in the house, what do you mean by that?
خانی دوستش برآمده بسیار اوراق که زیاد به مشکلات من خیستم برآمده بسیار خیلی تو وقتی که میشنی بشیم تو من میرم باز خیستیم بود چون من بگفتش نکرد که مگه یک کاری کنیم من سرصدا میکنم غال من غالک میکنم که پولیس بیه بفهمه که تو سرمت یک کار جبران میخوایی کنی
یعنی شراب خوردنه؟
نه فیل زناره اصلا نمود انا شراب خوری نیک کرد شراب خورن اول خواه میخواست که نه دالت باشم که هیچ نفهمم وقتی که میکنه نه که میگوید بخی کرد رفیق نه ده او اتاق رو وقتی که من خانه دوستش نرفتم خیست چادرم گرفت در گلونم تا گفت خواهید تو بگفتی من که نمی کنی من تو را میکشم باز من این آمانو که من چی کنم من همیشه در سر تخت بودم همیشه تو گروپ در پالین بود من همیشه تو گروپ بزرد گرفتم خیل کنم زدم در فرقش کنی من را ایلا کنه چون من را خفک می
Do you have any court documents or anything involving your case at all that's written?
چیزی نگفتنی فقط پای سال یک ما گفت خیدتون هستم شست ما که گفت ما گفتم که من قبول ندارم.
Did your attorney talk for you in court?
چازر نشده بودم که خودم از
خودم
کردیم. ابلاغ میگم مثلا مقام میتا که خیدت قبول کرد یا نکدیم من خیدت را تایید نکدیم.
Good girl.
و بیخیال سر شما بد نخورم به طبقی من بیخی سرم بد خوردم. چون شوهرم که از من نشد من دیگه چی کنم صرف ترس خداوند از کنگور مزید بگیم
All right, well, we're going to look at this, okay? And I think we can maybe help you write a defense statement for your second court if you want us to. And take all this and think about it and see what we can maybe come up with if you want us to help. Hi, how are you doing today?
Listen, such a progress.
I know we talked briefly last time. We're going to start today. We're not going to finish today. We're going to start talking to you
We see you talking to a young woman that has been sentenced for running away when her husband tried to force her to do things that she didn't want to do. And in the quotation here, it was said that she went back to her husband again. And the options for a woman like this woman in Afghanistan, what are they? As I can see, there are three options to actually stay with the husband or to move back to the parents or perhaps looking for a women's shelter and stay there. And here we saw that the woman came back to the husband. So what do you think about these options? Are there any real options or is this what mostly happens, that she goes back to the husband?
Well, there is a fourth option. You know, a woman could choose to live by herself. You know, that is an option. But what you saw there is an option that a lot of women do take, is that they do, you know, go back to their husbands to try to work things out. Frankly, in the West, there's a lot of women, unfortunately, that are victims, men and women, that are victims of domestic violence, and they do the same. The cycle of violence is a real thing that exists in every single country, you know, and so it's tough. You know, it's tough for Afghan women. I think it's tough for people around the world, you know, and we need to look at these scenes not as, oh, that happens in Afghanistan. It happens everywhere. You know, it may happen in different ways, but it happens in everywhere. You know, the UN just did a report last year that said that over 1 in 3 women on the planet right now has been or is a victim of domestic violence. So these things are not isolated incidents to Afghanistan, but they are things that happen everywhere. And frankly, those four options for women in Afghanistan are the same four options that women around the world also have. They can go back to their husband. They may or may not be able to go back to their families. They can go to a women's shelter, or they can choose to live on their own. There's consequences and pros and cons with each of these things, but I will say that in Afghanistan, by and large, the women will go back to their husbands and do go back to their husbands.
Of course, these things happen in Sweden as well, as you say, but I mean, the would you say then that the possibilities for an Afghan woman to live by herself is as good as the opportunity in, for example, Sweden or United States?
Well, definitely, Sweden has a lot more opportunities for women. Afghanistan, to be fair, is also a country that has a skewed number of women that are victims of violence. You know, according to Global Rights, at least over 85% of the women are victims of some type of physical or emotional abuse in Afghanistan. So it's much higher in the country. Most women in Afghanistan, unfortunately, are not as educated as women in Sweden, so they don't have the same opportunities. The mere fact that women can frankly walk the streets by themselves here is very different to what happens in Afghanistan. But again, like everything else, there are pros and cons. And I do know women that do live by themselves, and they are, you know, trying to do what they can to make a living for themselves. You know, and they're doing okay. They're not doing great, but it has to start somewhere, really. And I think those women are helping for it to start somewhere.
The example we saw, it could be an example of a pro bono case. I don't know, but maybe it is. Yeah. But could you explore a bit more on this relation between the cases that pays your bill and the pro bono? So how do you think about the relation? And could you explore a bit about that?
Sure. Well, I mean, the way my practice runs is it's an international legal practice. And so about 70% of my clients are paid clients. So I represent a lot of international companies as sort of the general counsel, a lot of different people around the world for criminal defense work, and also several embassies and ambassadors I represent. I represent the UK, the French, Italian, and UAE embassies and ambassadors. And also I represent a lot of larger NGOs around the world for different things. So that's about 70% of my clients. About 30% of my clients, it's probably actually a little bit more than 30%, fall under the umbrella of human rights cases, which is where you get the women's rights issues, or you might get the children's rights issue. I mean, to be frank, all three cases that you saw in the movie, Anthony Bevan and the lady, those are all pro bono cases, all three of them. And so I'm completely self-funded. I don't take grants from governments. I mostly pay for it myself, or I get private donations because I choose to operate that in that way, because I do respect NGOs and things like that, but that's not what I am. I'm an attorney who chooses to do pro bono human rights work when I want to. My focus is litigation, and I'm a global investor in human rights. So I invest my own capital, my own time in human rights, and I do that because I try to encourage other people and other businesses to develop some type of model like mine, where they also become global investors in human rights. And it's my way to try to work towards civilizing the economy by investing in human rights, because I understand that as a business owner, that investing in human rights is a capital gain in my business. And I want other people to do that, that are in the business sector, that are in the private sector, because that's so important. We shouldn't just rely on the Amnesty Internationals or the Human Rights Foundations to do that. We have a responsibility as individuals to really do that and understand that the economy is meant to serve the good of the people, and it's not the other way around. So this is how I choose to invest in human rights through my businesses and through the way I live my life, and that's how I've set up my business.
Thanks. Talking about NGOs, you say something in the film that I was had a reaction there. You said, I quote, no, the women's groups, you talk about the women's groups, and then I quote, they want attention and don't do a shit,
right.
You say, end of quote. So which are these groups that you talk about? Does this goes for all NGOs that are supposed to promote women's human rights? Or we have, for instance, we have a senior lecturer at the law department here in Gothenburg, Sadi Kuovo, who has written about the UN human rights system, but she has also worked in an EU office with women's human rights in Afghanistan. And, she has a more positive impression of the women's group. So I would like to ask you that question. So,
right.
Yeah.
Well, I certainly don't mean that every women's group or every NGO is useless. There are a lot of useless women's groups, a lot. But with that particular thing, what was setting me off is what was happening with that specific situation. And that specific situation was dealing with a case that I was personally involved in, where a little girl is being sold for $2,500 in the first jirga, because her father owed a debt to a neighbor. So the first jirga decided give the girl to the 19 or 20-year-old son to marry. The girl was 6. There are women's groups that sort of were up in our arms about this, rightfully so. And I had several people contact me to try to fix this. Once people contacted me, I then contacted the women's group to say, hey, press pause. You know, we're working on fixing this problem. Because what they were trying to do without really looking at the whole problem is they were trying to get the father arrested. Now, the father is the father of 8 children. They live in a refugee camp. His wife is very ill. The first jirga, he did not want to sell his daughter. He was against it, but he was outvoted. So if he went to prison, you best believe all the kids would have been sold. So anyway, I got involved, fixed it, you know, the debt was satisfied, the girl went back home, you know, and everything, which was good. Meanwhile, and then I contacted the women's groups back and I said, you know, the problem's been solved, the debt is satisfied, everyone is happy. Meanwhile, the women's groups, they continued to go to New York Times and said, hey, we have this story about this bad guy that sold his daughter. They didn't say the problem was fixed because they wanted to get their name in the New York Times. So that's what I was pissed off about. And so the New York Times then did this cover story about this girl that was sold and how awful the father was, never once mentioning that the problem had been solved. I contacted the journalist in New York Times to say, Alyssa, this is wrong. This is inaccurate. It needs to be updated. Because these are donors that provided me with the money to give to the people to satisfy the debt. So it looked like I stole the money, number one. And number two, the women's were trying to get in the New York Times because what they do is often is they get their name in the paper and then they go shop it around to different embassies and say, hey, my name's in the paper for this. People are trying to kill me. Give me asylum. That's the game. Or they go to their donors and they say, hey, my name's in the paper for this. Look at all the good stuff I'm doing for women's rights. And they try to get money off of that. You know, so I contacted the journalist and I said, Alyssa, this is wrong. Here's the number to the father, the neighbor, the boy, and all the other elders that were there. And I videotaped it. And the reason why was because I kept it very quiet. I didn't want necessarily the media to know that I had done this jirga. It was more for my records, mm-hmm. because I don't go to the journalist for everything. So she did her research. She found out that I was correct, and she had to do a very embarrassing thing as a journalist, which is she had to retract that story. And if you look up April 1st, 2012, she had to change what she had said, reported the day before, based on being lied to. And a lot of people in the U.S., April 1st is April Fool's Day, so they thought, you know, oh, this is a big joke. So that's what I was mad about. I was mad about them specifically lying about this situation, and they were blatantly lying.
So it was not a general statement.
It wasn't a general statement. It was those particular jerks that I was talking about.
Okay. Yeah. It's good to hear the explanation. So now I wonder if the audience have some questions. Yes, here we are. You have a microphone there, yeah.
Yes, I wonder about your own security in Afghanistan. Do you fear?
You know, I always feel like security really is a state of mind. So my security is good.
More questions?
Hello, very interesting to listen to this. I just wondered, how do you make the choices of your pro bono work? I mean, the selection. I guess you get a lot of questions to do that.
Good question. You know, it's very difficult because I have so many, 30%, I'm sure it's more than 30%. It's hard for me to say no, to be honest. And that's a really good and bad habit. So I take a lot of pro bono work. A lot of times sort of clients fall through the wayside. It sort of works itself out because with a lot of the pro bono work, there are certain obligations that the clients are going to have to do. Like for instance, I require them to get the legal paperwork for me instead of me sending my guys to get the legal files. You know, a lot of times people don't follow through with that. But it's hard. You know, I generally take a lot of cases. But, you know, if you're a person that, like I said in the movie, you have money, and I know you have money, I'm not going to, I mean, you have to pay. So I usually can weed them out pretty fast.
Are there any more questions?
Just about what it's like being a female working in that kind of culture. You talked earlier about what how it's all about working the culture and not necessarily the legal system. And I think especially in Afghanistan being the history it has mm-hmm. and just what it's like in that context.
Mm-hmm. Well, Afghanistan is very different from obviously where I'm from. And it's, I will say that for myself being a female working in Afghanistan, it makes me even stronger I think as a woman, myself personally, you know, and I feel it's even more important for me to be who I am, the woman I like to be, you know, in that situation. You know, the women have it so bad there. And I sort of compare it, calling it women's rights, I think pales in comparison to what it actually is. I think it's more the way women are treated there is really akin to how slaves were once treated. And the reason why I mean is because, you know, if a woman goes to the store by herself without permission, she can get arrested, just like slaves. You know, when a woman gets married, she has to take the name of her husband. She doesn't really have her own identity, you know, and so it's hard for a woman to, everything you have to get permission for, you know, going to school, getting property, even getting an ID card, you need to get permission of a man to do that. And it's extraordinarily frustrating to see that. And, you know, and so it's just, for me personally, I think it's even more important for me to be who I am as a woman in that environment because a lot of women aren't able to do that. And frankly, a lot of men aren't either, to be honest, but especially for the women. I think it's really, really important, if that makes sense.
More questions? While you are thinking, I can ask a question that I would like to hear a bit more about. The background for the film. So How did you meet the director, and whose idea was it to make the film, and how was it to have a TV team following you in both private and work life?
Well, I mean, the film sort of developed. That was a Danish journalist came to Afghanistan, and he wanted to meet. He had this idea for a film project. And originally, the way it was presented to me by him is that this was going to be a film about the legal system in Afghanistan. And I was going to be one of several people that was going to be part of this bigger film. And frankly, as a professional, I think it's important to see any legal system because you can really learn from it, you know, or not learn from it. And so that's why I was sort of somewhat interested to be involved. Now, and then he hooked up with Hella Faber, who's here, and Nicole Herhani, the director, and he sort of changed directions and decided to focus on me for whatever reason. And so, you know, I didn't think it was going to be like this, to be honest. Meaning, I really didn't want, for instance, too much of my personal life to come into it, but I developed this relationship with the directors, and to be honest, I was outvoted by my family and by Claude and my three kids. I didn't want them to be in the film. It still bothers me to see them in the film. Just from a personal standpoint, I keep it very separate. And so, you know, this project was a four-year real filming project. You know, it wasn't something that was done overnight, over a week's time, 4 years, you know, and I just, for me, what was it like? I really don't think I changed up who I was. I try to be who I am, you know, but it was nerve-wracking at times to have that camera there, I will say. But if you have a good cameraman, like Henrik, who's the cameraman, then you don't really notice them as much, which is really, I think, the job of a really good cameraman. He's a really good one. So it was strange. And then we sort of developed this relationship, which is cool.
Yeah. Anyone that has any more questions? Yeah.
Is the film to be shown in Afghanistan?
No.
No.
Yeah, that's a good question. So why?
I don't want it shown in Afghanistan.
No.
Yeah. Mm. That's not a place I want it shown.
Mm. But you have left Afghanistan now, or?
No, I just came from Afghanistan here.
Because I got the impression in the film is ending when you go to Uganda, is it?
No. I was just going to check out Uganda to see what was going on there. But I moved my office in Afghanistan, but I'm still working there.
Okay. Yeah. I have one last question before we wrap it up here. You said something not in the film, but in the TED Talk. That justness is using laws for their intended purpose to protect. Using laws for their intended purpose to protect. But then my question is, to protect what? Is it always the individual, or could it also be to protect a system that actually is exploiting of individuals?
I mean, it's a good question. Using laws to protect the individual and to protect all of us. You know, laws are supposed to be for us as people. You know, and that's what I do, is I work the system from the inside out, and I use justness, like you said, which is using laws for the purpose of protecting us as individuals. And the byproduct is also helping to protect the system. And I find that in my travels, unfortunately, people don't realize the laws exist. Often culture supersedes the laws, or people just don't read the laws. They don't know what those laws are. And so I feel like that's really part of my duty, is to try to encompass all those three things with people and with my cases and individuals, and to really build up, you know, a legal system globally that will help protect all of us. And we need to understand that, again, a case, a little girl that's being sold in Afghanistan or being abused, a girl, woman being abused in Afghanistan, is not just that one individual case. It represents a microcosm of a bigger issue. And the laws are meant for all of us. And I really want people to understand that, just like, you know, with our clothes and tangible things, I look at law very tangibly, that I own it, that it belongs to me, that it has a life. And it's my job to use those laws to enhance my life, to protect my life. And so that's what I try to use by creating a I guess in essence a justness world or a justness league of laws to protect all of us, because we need to understand that our world is a lot more connected than we once were. And that, you know, I was just reading that there's this, according, you know, there's this theory about 6 degrees of separation, how we're all 6 degrees from each other. Well, now we're all 4.74 degrees of separation from each other, according to scientists at the University of Milan and Facebook, because Facebook has scientists now. And so that means that our global dysfunctional family is a lot more connected now than we ever have been. And so these laws mean even more for us now than they ever have been. And so it's very important to use these laws, to use justness to enhance us as a culture and as a legal community, because protecting one of us protects all of us. And so that's what I mean by justness. Mm-hmm.
So then the title of the discussion is, with a bit adjustment, it is correct, a global culture of law, including human rights.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you very much, Kimberly Motley, for coming here and having this discussion. And I really appreciate it. And I hope you did as well. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Oh, that's nice. Thank you.